During the 1970s and 80s, Rod Hull was a top-ranking star in British show business. He was the darling of the chat show circuit and a multi-millionaire.
See?
His slapstick routine with an oversized glove puppet made of raffia was an unlikely success that took him to Hollywood and back. But when he died, he was worth less than £2,000. This is the story of the man behind the uncontrollable emu and the fortune he made and lost.
So is that the emu you've got there?
No.
Oh, okay.
Just my jacket.
In 1999, Rod Hull was booked for what would turn out to be his last gig.
A bit heavy.
He once pulled in television audiences of 11 million and was one of Britain's best-loved entertainers. On the 13th of February, he was paid just £500 to perform at a 30th birthday bash in a London bar.
What about emu? Does he not drink? Can he not have a Swifty?
Only cabbage.
Oh, OK.
Rod's declining years were spent eking out a living, surviving on a meagre income from occasional bookings with a famous sidekick he'd come to hate.
So we're going in there, yeah?
1 month later, he was dead, killed in a bizarre accident that put him back in the headlines for the very last time.
Cheers.
Tributes were paid today to the TV comic Rod Hull, who died in a bizarre accident at his home in Sussex. Hull, loved and feared for the antics of his puppet emu, was trying to adjust his TV aerial when he fell off the roof.
64 years earlier, in 1935, Rodney Stephen Hull was born to a bus conductor and his wife. Rod and his younger sister Joan were brought up on a small council estate on the Isle of Sheppey.
Rod's comedy was a sort of defence mechanism, because Rod used to stutter, and it took a while to get over that stuttering. And on top of that, it was a way of, OK, I'm not the real tall, good-looking, smart fellow, but I'm funny.
He was naturally funny. And even going back to his early school days, I can remember he had a very unique sense of humour. I mean, he was an awful practical joker. He couldn't resist. He couldn't resist a joke if it was there regardless.
As he entered his teens, Rod began to nurture ambitions to be an entertainer, and he and best friend Bill Wallace let their makeshift double act loose on an unsuspecting public.
We ended up doing a comedy act together for the local concert party, and then we did a few shows on our own. And I was a straight man, and he was the comedian. But it was just a dreadful comedy act. I would play the pianos, and Rod would supposedly be a child protege on the violin. It was a dreadful act, but it was popular at the time. And we thought we were marvellous. We thought this was it. This is showbiz, you know.
The act may have been singularly unimpressive, but it was enough to win over Rod's childhood sweetheart. He met Sandra, a 15-year-old hairdresser from his hometown, and in 1958, they were married. Rod became an apprentice electrician, but in his heart he still yearned to break into the entertainment industry. By now, his sister Joan had emigrated to Australia and was trying to persuade her brother to follow.
I'd only been here a couple of years, and I kept writing about all these letters saying, this is a wonderful country, and they hadn't got television here yet. And then they did get television here, and I kept writing to Rod saying, this is where you should work.
Rod set off in 1960 on a £10 assisted passage, a one-way ticket to a new life in Australia with his young bride.
Hello, good King Minstrel.
With television in its infancy, Rod finally got the show business break he'd been aching for.
Rod came into Channel 9 on our lighting staff. But he always had his eye on being a performer. And he got in with a series called the Caper Cops.
The part of Constable Clot was played by Rod Hull.
He was very good at what he did. He was played the role, really, of a Stan Laurel character.
His role on the simplistic and slapstick Caper Cops led to further work on the most popular nightly show down under, The Tonight Show with Don Lane. And it wasn't long before he persuaded his old comedy partner Bill to move from Britain to Australia and join him on the show.
What do I want on my back?
Yes.
I want him.
We were working on a Tonight Show, which had high ratings. I think it was the most popular show in Australia at the time, hosted by an American guy called Don Lane. And he did a number of sketch appearances on that, and he became, you know, a fall guy on it. So, yeah, he was pretty well known. I mean, if you walk down the street, they would say, you know, there's Rod Hull, or there's, you know, Constable Clot from Caper Cops.
It was the mid-1960s, and life down under was good. Over the next 5 years, Rod and Sandra settled in a North Sydney suburb and had two children, Debbie and Danielle. Rod relished the life of a family man.
We were very happy, completely happy. I mean, he absolutely adored the girls. And he used to love coming home. He was more or less the same at home as he was on television. Mad as a hatter.
By the late 1960s, Rod was a star of the fledgling Australian television industry, even landing a role alongside one of Australia's biggest stars.
Hello? I'm sorry I failed you, Mr.
Pennyweather, Mervyn Pennyweather. But how did you come to find me here?
Skippy smelt you out. Didn't you, Skip?
Talking kangaroo.
Rod got another lucky break after persuading actor Warren Mitchell, now internationally famous as Alf Garnett, to appear on The Tonight Show.
He was working for Channel 9 and they were paying him a pittance. I mean, it was disgraceful, really. He was writing, I think, two episodes of In Melbourne Tonight and performing in them and getting paid nothing. And I said, I'll pay you three times what Channel 9 are paying you to come and stooge for me.
Rod soon discovered that being one of the stars of the show made him irresistible.
I'd be doing my act. Rod would be on to start with, and he'd have a couple of little entrances during my act, but not very much. And he'd stay in the room and watching the audience, and he'd pick out the prettiest girls, and he'd go up to me and say, would you like to meet the star afterwards? And they'd say, oh, yeah. And he'd bring them with the boyfriend up to my room. It was my job to distract the boyfriend. Like, come and look at the view, isn't it wonderful? Whilst he chatted up the bird and got her phone number. I mean, I was a pimp, virtually. I was pimping for Rod Hull.
With Rod, whatever he did, there was always an element of, let's try and attract the girls. I mean, I think that was a major factor in his life, not just when he was young, right the way through.
He was unlikely as a lecher. He was a tremendous lecher, I mean, no question. Very hot pants, old Rod Hull. But he never looked like that.
It was around this time that Rod claimed he found Emu, a discarded puppet in the props cupboard at Channel 9. It led to a pairing that would outlast every other partnership in his life.
I know this is a picture of here, of him without any feathers on. When he was just a little baby. Look.
When Emu came on the scene, Rod brought him home one night. And I bent down to switch the television off and switch the television on, and suddenly there was Emu, you know, goosing me. I turned around, it was Rod with this bloody great Emu, and he was laughing and jerking. He told me how it was going to be used on the show. They were suited together. I mean, there was Emu with that wild head and those yellow legs that went on forever, and Rod's legs went on forever. They were a matched pair.
You're so lucky to have a friend like me.
Rod soon mastered handling Emu. He had a unique gift for physical comedy and brought the mute puppet to life. They were soon inseparable.
You're so lucky to have a friend like me, to help the day along, to cheer you with a song or two.
The discovery of Emu changed Rod's life forever and took him, bird in hand, back to Britain.
Troubles ahead, side. You're so lucky to have a friend like me.
Rod Hull came across us. He came from Australia. We represented at the time Rolf Harris. And anybody from Australia who was looking for representation ended up at our office, because Rolf would say to anybody, if ever you're in London, go to International Artists. So Rod Hull turned up at the office, unannounced, uninvited, no appointment, one afternoon. And a more diffident, reserved, shy man you couldn't wish to meet. And he had this suitcase with him, which we assumed had his worldly goods inside. And he came into the office and then said he did this act with an emu. And he opened the case and brought the emu out, and the emu kind of almost exploded out of the case because it was cramped in, and it just blossomed in front of our very eyes. On his arm, it seemed to appear on his arm by magic, and this diffident, mild man seemed to then be trying to control this other being. And it annihilated the office. I couldn't believe it. It absolutely tore the desks all to pieces, contracts, everything, and he's trying to hold it back. I'm watching, and she's watching, and chaos, and dust, and cops, and it was unbelievable. And I laughed. I thought it was the funniest thing I'd ever seen. And he finally seemed to manage to get it under control and pulled it back and then apologised for it.
Within days, his agent had booked Rod on the UK's primetime Saturday variety show. It was Rod's first appearance on British television and was the springboard to a lucrative 20-year career at the top.
Pick up the hammer, you see, and then you bring it down with a sharp blow on his lips.
His private life was also about to change drastically. His 16-year marriage came to an end when he met 25-year-old commercial artist Cher Hilton.
No laughing matter, you know.
Comfortable. By the early 1970s, Rod Hull was signed to one of London's leading showbiz agents and was now a sought-after regular on TV variety shows.
Comfortable? Right. You're going to sleep. Go to sleep.
Rod had brought his wife Sandra and their daughters from Australia to pursue his career in the UK. But unbeknownst to Sandra, he was already planning to leave her.
I think it was beginning the way, although he was still very affectionate when he used to come home for the weekend. He didn't change, because I had no inkling at all. You know, I couldn't see there was anything wrong. And then one day, something came up, and I just asked a question of it, and he just suddenly said that he didn't want family life anymore. I was shattered.
She lost a lot of weight, Mum did. I think really through sheer worry, because, I mean, she'd grown up with Dad since being a teenager. They'd had their life together in Australia and obviously come back to England to start a new life together. So, and right at the beginning of it, basically, she was dropped this bombshell.
Whilst in Australia, Rod had met and fallen in love with Cher, the woman who was to become his second wife.
When I very first saw him, I thought, skinny, gangly, this zany, crazy character, unattractive. Awful to say, but he was fairly persistent and terribly romantic.
It seemed to be like a super glue romance between them. They, you know, he loved Sandra very much and he adored his children, but when Cher came into his life, suddenly it was Cher and that was it.
At the time, Cher was also married, but Rod had made up his mind to pursue her.
He seemed intent on pursuing me, so it must have been quite a strong feeling. I then decided I was returning to England and he wanted to return to England, so I went first and then he followed.
Cher was instrumental in his success. I think she was able to see the potential that he had, perhaps more than Sandra did, who just loved him for the man he was, for the boy she met on the Isle of Sheppey and grew up with.
Cher gave him the confidence to overcome insecurities about his looks and ability. She was to become an active force in his career. And together, Rod and Cher were a powerful combination. Within a year of Rod's return, 18 million viewers saw him perform for the Queen Mother at the 1972 Royal Variety Performance.
With Emu, he decided, because he couldn't vent, he couldn't throw his voice, that the only way to make Emu work would be to have it really, really aggressive and over the top. So that would cover for the fact that he couldn't throw his voice.
Rod was unique because of Emu not having a voice. It was a sort of parody of an animal act, that he was like the trainer whose animal was misbehaving. So you could say there's sort of analogy with Tommy Cooper with magic tricks not going right.
This trick is quite a difficult trick, and it's taken us 3 years to learn. And it's only been done through patience and kindness, understanding, and getting to know the animal. What he's going to do now is going to leap through this hoop which I've got down here.
After his Royal Variety spot, Rod became one of the most recognisable faces in show business overnight.
You wouldn't have put any bets on a man with an emu on his arm that doesn't speak suddenly becoming a major star in the UK. You just wouldn't. But if he'd made his mind up that he was going to do something, he would do it come hell or high water. And it paid off.
Mr. Howell, could I speak to you?
Yes?
You said that this was a performing emu.
Yes, it is, yes.
Hasn't done anything, has it?
Well, in a minute...
Well, has he?
No, well, not yet, but... soon.
Well, have you? You! I'm talking to you.
We were chosen the cast of Till Death Us Depart to do the command performance. Johnny Spate wrote a very funny sketch. And who was on before us at the command performance, dragging Dickie Henderson all over the stage? And the audience wasn't laughing, my dear. They were howling. I've never heard laughter like it in the Palladium. And we've got to follow him. It was amazing.
Rod's style of anti-establishment anarchy continued backstage. It made him headline news.
Standing in the lineup with Emu was something that the organisers didn't necessarily want, but if anyone was going to get their photograph in the papers, it would be Emu attacking the bouquet.
Everything followed from that. It was like having a hit record. It was like going straight to number one on the charts. You had to fend off rather than worry about it. I mean, it happened so quickly and sustained for so long. You never really had to worry about where the next job came from. It was only what that job was and where it led to.
By 1973, Rod was seriously in demand, and the BBC signed him to front his own children's TV series. Ba-ba-ba.
Emu's Broadcasting Company.
It brought him into the nation's living rooms every week and made him extremely famous. But his newfound celebrity came at a price.
He was aware of the fact that in order to get the kind of money to live the kind of life he wanted, he had to put up with being famous. But he was never comfortable with the kind of intrusion that would occur.
People would either stop and stare or follow us round, which was really stupid. I mean, I don't know what they expected him to do. And of course, he was such a different character to the man with Emu, which is what they knew. I mean, he was such a private person. I mean, this was a horror to him.
Rod found huge success in children's television with Emu, but as a mainstream act, he was all too aware that he was only seen as the straight man behind the anarchic bird.
He wanted to be a writer. He wanted to sit in his study with his pipe, with his brandy, with his chocolate, and just write, and then send scripts out there. The performing was more thrust on him, but he was so good at it that that's all people ever let him do. You know, they didn't see that there was this man with something more to offer, much more to offer.
Rod was frustrated by the emu, which he increasingly saw as an albatross. He enjoyed a love-hate relationship with the puppet. His 1976 appearance on Parkinson bound the two together forever.
When he went in to do it, he was disappointed that he didn't see Parkinson before the show, and then that they insisted he do it with emu. So then he decided, as soon as he goes on, right, I'll rip up the script.
Oh, my God.
Is that yours?
Yes, it's mine.
Let's have it. What are you going to do now? He's lost without it, you know.
Rod, well, he was worried about doing Parkinson because he said there's a conflict. I should be interviewed as Rod Hull without the emu. Yet television people wanted him with emu because that was funny, that worked, it was good television. But to do an interview like that, then he can't be that serious man.
Rod's rebellious antics on Parkinson remain an all-time TV favourite. Voted 13th in television's 100 Greatest Moments, it beat Charles and Diana's Wedding by 17 places. It made such a mark on Michael Parkinson that to this day he's reluctant to talk about the mauling.
I don't think we quite realised the impact that it was going to have. I'd love to say to you, this was a planned career move, and aren't we all geniuses in actually saying to Rod, I tell you what you do, he don't like it, you do that, and it's going to be marvellous, and the next day you'll be a major star. But we didn't. And it threw Michael. I think he wanted to wring Rod's neck, but he really wanted to wring the emu's neck.
Everybody would love to attack the interviewer. These pompous interviewers that come on. Emu did it. He'd brought back into comedy violence, which had been missing for a long time. When you look at the silent movies like Chaplin, Buster Keaton and that, it was very violent.
It's somewhere deep in his subconscious was a desire to cause havoc. But he never could bring himself to do it himself. But he could use the emu.
The introspective Rod Hull, who in private preferred more intellectual pursuits, revealed a darker side when under the wing of emu.
He was able to enact what he wanted to do through emu and be a little bit more devilish than what he should have been.
As part of the act, he would leave the stage and emu would start attacking members of the audience. And I noticed on occasions that emu would grab hold of a lady's boobs, go under the skirt, or grab a guy by the goolies. And I thought, hold on a minute, there's Rod Hull's hand in the beak of the emu. And it's that hand that is attacking the people.
I think some of the people that were attacked by emu, some of them knew how to handle it, others were just embarrassed.
When I told him about this, he agreed that it wasn't right. And at the next performance, he did it the same way.
If he had an idea and he thought it was going to be funny, he would go off and do it. Didn't matter what the consequences would be. And that was half the fun, really.
Rod married Cher in 1978. He was a loving father to Cher's daughter and their own three children. And life for the new Hull family was rosy.
The high-flying bird flies above.
Thanks to emu, Rod enjoyed a very lucrative career in Britain. He claimed it was all the result of a chance find in the props cupboard at Channel 9. But there are those who tell a different tale about emu's origins.
I was in Australia with the two Ronnies. We went to a club and we saw an act called Marty Morton.
Oh, hey! Here he is!
And he did the Rod Hull and emu act. So after the show, we introduced him and said, how come you're allowed to do that act? He said, it's not, it's my act. He said, Rod Hull was working on a TV show. It was devised by the Channel 9 network in Australia for a TV series. And when Rod came back to England, he took the emu with him.
In fact, Emu was a Channel 9 creation. After Rod left Australia, the Channel hired Marty Morton to operate the Emu.
You've laid an egg in my mouth. What are you going to say about that? Happy Easter.
But producer Jim Badger claims he found the puppet, and before Rod left, he taught Rod to work the Emu.
I put the Emu on and demonstrated how the thing worked. He said, I don't want to be a puppeteer. I said, you are not a puppeteer. This is a double act, and this thing has got more brains than you've got.
I asked him about it once, and he got a little bit funny about it. I asked Rod why he was using Emu when it was part of the show over there. He said, oh, it's my creation.
Unbeknownst to me, Rod had another Emu made here in Australia before he left.
Let me tell you of an interview we had with an old man.
It was a topic on which Rod, like Emu, preferred to stay stum. Marty Morton, meanwhile, is still performing to audiences in Sydney.
Now, I can't fly, but I'm telling you, I can run the pants of a kangaroo. But I do, 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 Emu can't fly, but I'm telling you, we can run the pants of a kangaroo. Hey!
By the mid-1980s, Rod was earning big money. Apart from his television shows and merchandising deals, he was a popular choice for adverts. Rod and his scrawny sidekick had even made it across the Atlantic and onto the highest-rating talk show in the world.
There's a way of making friends with him if you have to go, who's a pretty emu then? Who wants a little chucky-chucky-chucky-choo? See? See not?
No.
You try it.
No, don't. Stop here. Yeah.
Who's a little emu?
Oh,
look,
he likes you.
See? Yeah.
that bird doesn't like me.
Though warned by the cast and producers not to attack the $25 million a year host, true to form, Rod was unable to resist. The attack made such an impact that Rod attracted the attention of America's biggest box office star of the 80s.
I'll tell you what I might have. I might have emu kiosk for breakfast.
Hollywood A-lister Burt Reynolds loved Rod's brand of anarchic humor so much that the heartthrob booked him to co-star in a comedy show.
Don't let these flowers fool you, but Mr. Reynolds has a black belt in karate.
That's right.
Rod was even courted by Princess Diana. He was invited to Kensington Palace to make a private appearance at Prince William's 4th birthday party.
Look! We're getting bigger!
Success at home and around the world had made Rod a major star. His shows pulled in as many as 11 million viewers. But stardom gave Rod an inflated sense of self-importance.
He could be, I have to say, as far as his work is concerned, self-centred. Some would say that he was very professional.
Rod was difficult to produce because the act really never changed. It was a number of routines with Emu, and then somebody, the star of the show or a stooge, walking in, and then the Emu attacking the stooge. And Rod always, when he came to rehearse, made out that this was some great Hollywood epic that we were going to do.
His producer had to be a strong character to sort of say, no, Rod, I want it done like this. And Rod would say, blah, 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 blah. But then he would agree. You know, that was just his ego.
Rod longed to be taken seriously, to be seen as more than the man with the emu. He felt increasingly overshadowed by his golden goose.
If you're successful, the public really only ever see you. Just all they ever ask is, where's the emu? I think that drove him crazier than anything else, was where's the emu?
We all want to change something we've got, and the more popular and big the puppet gets, the more unsure you are of yourself, and I think that's what happened to Rod. At times, he hated Emu, absolutely hated him. But then he knew how popular Emu was, and he knew without Emu, then Rod Hull would not get all the adulation.
Goodbye to the sky. I know I can't fly, but I feel love. Do you know how I feel? You are my Achilles heel. Hello to below. I feel love flow like a river flow. You are not standing still. You are my Achilles heel.
Adulation was something Rod wasn't short of. Fame had transformed the craggy-faced comedian into one of entertainment's most unlikely Casanovas.
He did have a reputation as a ladies' man. I think most of them, it was because of his position in show business, and I suppose you'd call them star fuckers.
There was a story going around that Rod was quite a big guy in the male department, but I mean, I can't comment on that. I never saw him changing in a dressing room. Although someone did, they said they did see him crawling around once on all fives.
To be quite honest, in some instances, it was totally offered, and he was a man.
Yeah, that was part of our lives, and although they hurt at the time, it was something that I really came to terms with.
I think not so much that he was a philanderer, but he couldn't resist. He wasn't God's greatest gift sort of thing to look at, but I think he couldn't resist proving himself, if you like, that he was attractive to women.
If it's flippant, nothing, one-nighty flip, yeah. Who cares, you know? Doesn't matter. Away, I don't know. Doesn't matter. If they became more, if there was more to it, then I would certainly put my foot down, definitely.
In 1987, at the height of the entertainer's earning power, the couple bought a magnificent 32-bedroomed Elizabethan townhouse in Rochester, Kent. When Rod bought his 16th-century mansion for a modest £275,000, life was sweet, but the good times were to be short-lived.
You know, when they first moved into Restoration House, it seemed wonderful. It's got a wing, and then it goes along there, and it's got another wing. And basically, half of this wing was livable. That's all.
Scaffolding was around the house for at least 18 months. Workers working all that time, and it just made us dry, you know. It just took everything.
To make matters worse, in 1988, with Rod's expenditure at an all-time high, ITV executives axed his show.
I think the network had decided we'd run our time. I'd just come off the set and Rod came into the dressing room. And there were several of us there. And he said, right, as of now, we have finished. This is the end. And he looked round and he said, I'm not your meal ticket any longer.
For Rod, it was a financial disaster. The crash in property values and soaring interest rates crushed Rod just when his capacity to earn big money had disappeared.
With the recession hitting, the house was on the market, but there were no interested people, you know, and that's when we started to see this is not good.
By the early 1990s, Rod Hull had not been seen on British television screens for 3 years. He worked long hours for relatively low pay on the variety circuit in an attempt to pay off his huge debts. On top of that, Rod and Cher were hit with an enormous bill for unpaid taxes, dating back several years. It was a shocking realization.
This is massive. We owe money to the banks for Restoration House. There isn't enough money coming in to cover that. And we owe huge monies to the tax people.
As far as Rod was concerned, as long as he had money in the bank, he didn't worry about how much or where it had come from. He simply got about his life, and I think the same may have been true of Cher. I didn't know her so well. A sensible person, a more businesslike person, would take an interest and wonder why they hadn't been paying very much tax on what seemed quite a lot of income. But I don't think it occurred to Rod generally.
We're at fault for not chasing up and making sure that everything was done each year, but I just didn't think that you need to do that if you've got an accountant.
On the 8th of September 1994, Rod Hull was officially declared bankrupt and his glorious Elizabethan mansion repossessed.
I know Rod was terribly disappointed that it had happened, and when it happened so quickly, and he was embarrassed, desperately embarrassed.
The downturn in the Hulls' fortunes caused a serious fracture in an already strained marriage, and Cher now decided to take herself and the children back to her native Australia.
It wasn't nice. I couldn't help but feel that some family members felt that I'd run away at a time that Rod needed me, which really is not the case at all. And I don't believe he felt I'd abandoned him, because he knew the children were better off here.
Rod's daughters from his first marriage felt differently.
You know, when the bankruptcy happened, in our view, she should have stuck here and weathered it out here with him.
In a few short months, Rod Hull had lost his home and his family. He was left in England, stuck with the inescapable emu, while his wife and children started a new life in Australia.
Welcome to the month. May's entertainment CD-ROM from the Sunday Times. Be one of the first to sample the brand new album from Prince. And 120 tracks from May's biggest albums. Preview 9 spectacular films and our exclusive 30-minute feature on The Day After Tomorrow. It's simply too big to miss.
Appearances can be deceptive. The new Alpha GT.
Extra lows at B&Q means thousands of our low prices just got lower.
There's 20% off all outdoor plants.
20% off all exterior paint and exterior wood care.
20% off mowers means our low prices just got lower.
There's 20% off all decking.
And garden furniture.
Plus 20% off all barbecues.
These amazing savings end Thursday, 29th of April.
Don't miss out. Our low prices just got lower.
Smart move, Dave. Consolidated with Dell Power Edge servers.
Uh-huh.
Highly available, highly scalable. Intel Xeon processors. Cuts costs across the board. So you're not going to miss those old servers, right?
Oh, Tony. What did you do with the old servers?
Nothing.
That's our drinking fountain, isn't it?
You mean Hydra?
Find out how you could cut costs across your enterprise easy as Dell. Go online today.
Come on, we're here. Lucky!
Quick, the door.
There he goes, Dad.
If you're a safe driver, More Than Car Insurance lets you protect your maximum no-claim discount and keep it protected for life, however many bumps or scrapes you have.
Dad!
In fact, More Than promised that your premium will never go up just because you've made a claim.
That's lucky. That's more than lucky.
Car insurance, don't accept less than More Than. Call 0800 300 202. It's a real winner.
How I love to salsa. Oh, how I love
okay,
to salsa.
Okay, Rosita, you love to salsa. Could we have quiet now?
No way. Here comes Crazy Dolores. Oh, it's impossible. I go.
Me too. But only this place have the pure squeezed orange.
Oh, I love you, Rosita. I love you.
Love and
just me, Mac.
Can you smoke?
Tropicana. Nothing added, nothing taken away.
All over South America,
This gesture means everything's okay. Apart from Brazil, where it's rather rude. We never underestimate the importance of local knowledge. HSBC, the world's local bank.
Would you risk your life savings to open a fashion store? That's what the Harveys have done.
Nothing. I know nothing about fashion.
So can they cut it in the fashion world? Follow the Harveys as they gamble everything they've got.
Can you leave this to me?
No. Risking it all, Wednesday at 9 on 4.
You shouldn't put that kind of pressure on me.
Now officially bankrupt, Rod was in dire need of an income. But the only television work on offer was appearances on talk shows to discuss his spectacular downfall.
Who wants to be a millionaire? Rod Hull was a millionaire, but he let it slip through his fingers. Rod, what? You've not only been a millionaire, you've also been bankrupt?
Yes.
You used to live like this.
Like what?
That.
Yes.
And now you live like this?
Yes.
What interests me is, did your friends stay with you? Your friends in show business, did they stay with you?
No, that was an unfortunate thing. You know, I'd worked with a lot of people for a lot of years and given work to a lot of people as well. But once that happened, you know, the phone just went quiet.
What's your life like?
I think to never have had it might have been easier, but to have had it as he did and lost it and lose everything... I mean, his home, as I say, the family moved to Australia. To find himself quite desolate at that age in life would have been extremely hard. And you could just see this sadness in his eyes, really, that everything wasn't as it should be. And he was quite sort of broken, really.
Having lost the splendid Grade 1 listed restoration house, Rod now lived in a small National Trust cottage on the Kent-Sussex border. He could just afford a token rent of £20 a week on the isolated bungalow.
I can remember when we went down to see Shepherd's Cottage, which really was a derelict Shepherd's Cottage. We were just gobsmacked that he was even going to consider living there.
Breakfast in motion.
But live there he did. Despite his humiliating demise, Rod remained positive and started to slowly rebuild his life. In 1996, his 18-year-old son Oliver came back from Australia to live with him, and they became regulars at the local pub in Icklesham.
Hooray!
It was so nice to see him truly happy in his own surroundings.
Not their show prize leaks.
And to see him at this little cottage where the people up the pub knew him as Rod. Not as Rod Hull and Emu, not as the fame, not as anything, just as a nice bloke, Rod. They liked him for him, and it was lovely to see that.
He took the dirty bugger into bed or something. I can't remember.
The first time I met Hot Rod, he walked past the end of the bar there with this huge pipe in his hand, and I looked at him. He had a deerstalker hat on. I looked at that man and I thought, that's an interesting face. It looks lived in, a nice man. And we got chatting. He bought me a pint. I bought him a pint. He said, I can't buy another one. I haven't any money. I'm bankrupt. So I said, well, that makes two of us. But before he did anything, he had to check with how much was in the account. And if it was a bad time, poor old Hot Rod would say, well, I can't buy a pint today. I'll buy you one next week when I've brought a bit of loot in, you know. He was a generous man and a splendid fellow.
Although Rod was stony broke and now in his early 60s, he never lost his ability to charm the opposite sex. He had several relationships during his time in Icklesham.
We met with mutual friends in a local pub. There always seemed to be the element of alcohol around. He did love a bevy or two. And we immediately enjoyed one another's company. We used to walk across fields together, gather field mushrooms, cook them for breakfast, make love down by the water's edge.
On June the 10th, I met him. On June the 24th, I moved in with him. It was love at first sight.
Kate, I think that was purely bad news.
It was nice that he could share his life, and I felt a privilege that I was the one he wanted to share it with. and they are the happiest years of my life.
He needed a lady. He needed to have love and affection. And, if I wasn't there, then somebody else would be.
I was always quite a lad to have around in that sort of sense. I remember one time coming home from college and seeing a car in the driveway and turning around on my motorbike and going back up to the pub, ringing him from the pub saying, "I'm coming home at 11, Dad. I don't care if she's there or not, but just I'm coming home at 11. And it's sort of like, I'm 20 years old, I'm 19 years old saying this to my father. Shouldn't this be the other way around?
Yes, I think he was quite popular with the ladies.
That's proud of him.
Yeah.
Rod's new lifestyle was simple and self-sufficient. He ran the cottage himself, including regularly adjusting the troublesome TV aerial.
Mobile.
But he still had to work to survive, which left only one option, to unpack Emu and get out on the road.
One of his great frustrations as a performer was, of course, that the Emu was both the reason for his success and also, in a scene later years, the reason perhaps he wasn't able to extend his talent the way that he wanted to. People really only wanted the Emu.
The comedian now hated Emu so much that whenever he could, he left the bird at home.
They asked Rod to appear on the Comedy Awards, and he turned up without the Emu. And everybody was furious.
We said, "Well, where's Emu?" He said, "You didn't write in the letter Rod Hull and Emu, so I'm here." I said, "Well, can we get Emu?" He said, "Oh, no, he's in a suitcase on his way to pantomime and somewhere."
Rod rather resented the fact that he'd only been asked to appear on the Comedy Awards to present an award because he had the Emu, not in his own right.
I went mad and I said, "Well, you know, what are we going to do?"
"You're not feeding it, are you?"
And so Rod came on stage on his own. Jonathan Ross made a comment on that. And as far as I was concerned, that was the last time I worked with him.
There you go. Rod Hull and Emu, I like to compare them to the splendid bejeweled clock tower in the centre of Times Square, New York, ladies and gentlemen. That hasn't worked since 1978 either.
He always wanted to be known for more than Emu. Rod tried to create new avenues for his talents and even published a book of poetry, but his efforts to break free never succeeded.
I don't think Rod could really have done anything without Emu. I think he was so much tied to Emu in public perception. He wasn't a comedy actor, he wasn't a singer, he wasn't a dancer.
I think his career faltered because, like everybody who's got a novelty comedy act, when the novelty wears off, where do you go?
You can't sort of say that Rod was a Benny Hill or an Eric Morecambe or a Tommy Cooper. He was a strange little gimmicky thing that happened, as often happens in show business. You
know? Have you got Oliver?
By the late 1990s, Rod's heyday was long behind him, but he'd found contentment in a simpler existence.
So much. I like this. I feel really good now.
When Dad came back, I mean, it wasn't sort of showbiz Dad because he wasn't working. He didn't have commitments to dash off and do jobs. He was a lot more kinder and patient and contented.
I got to know my father on a completely new level. It's almost like he'd gone full circle. He'd hit the heights and he'd gone back to a little home, and I think he was happy.
Rod Hull, the comedian famous for his antics with his puppet Emu, has died after an accident at his home. He fell off the roof of his house in Sussex while apparently trying to adjust the aerial to watch last night's big football match.
I was sitting on the couch and said, "Oh, I'll go up and fix it." And he said, "No, I'll do it. And obviously now I feel terrible that I didn't go up. But so he went outside to go and do the aerial. And I heard one small thud and then a much bigger thud. And I thought, well, that sounded very, very weird. And went walking out there and shouted out his name, and obviously no reply. And I went walking past him, and I know I walked right past him. And I don't I think I must have seen him, but I think that maybe there was a part in my brain that thought, please don't let it be that, so just ignore it. And then as I walked past, it clocked again that may have been it, but I went running back and checked up on the roof and climbed up on the roof to see if I could see him all around. And then when I was up on the roof, I looked down and then I could see him lying there.
Oliver called, phone call, was dreadful. He was just saying, Dad's fallen, can't get a pulse. I said, have you called an ambulance? He said, yes.
They arrived, and I said, you need torches and whatnot, and so they got that, and they brought it round. When they shone the torch down, it was not the prettiest thing in the world to behold.
I knew Rod had gone, because if you can't get a pulse, yeah. But I felt... I felt for Oliver.
It was just like so unreal. It was just...
When you think he wasn't a great lover of watching the television.
Well, the climbing up on the roof was such a stupid thing to do, but that was Rod, you know. Oh, I can do that. I'll go and fix the aerial. You've been up there 1,000 times before, you know. Not always in the dark, of course.
He had to go some extraordinary way. Just getting sick and dying slowly just wouldn't have been right for him.
Rod was buried in a small graveyard in the middle of his favourite golf course. And while there may have been a notable absence of celebrities at his funeral, there was no shortage of mystery mourners.
At his funeral, I can't tell you the number of ladies who came up to me afterwards and said, hello, I was a very good friend of your brother's. One of them asked me for a sweater, and I said, look, I'm sorry, but it's nothing to do with me. You'll have to ask his wife, because Cheryl was still married to him, even though she lived over here. And I thought, what can you do?
Rod Hull managed to squeeze a 25-year career out of his brilliant 10-minute act. Though he came to hate the emu, the mischievous pair's antics were loved by millions. The comedy double act gave him a privileged and successful life. But in the end, the price Rod had to pay was that his talent had to live in the shadow of a puppet called Emu.
Next on 4, we chart the rise of an ambitious Skies girl who was spotted in the right place at the right time. Scylla, in Black and White.